Welcome back to the Best Wines Online Tasting Room. I'm Kyle Meyer, and next to me is the world famous Gavin Chanin.
Thank you for having me.
Are you world famous?
No.
Well, not yet.
Not yet. I'm working on it, slowly but surely.
You're working on it. I mean, how long does it take to become world famous in the world of wine?
I think about 40 years.
About 40? Okay. Yeah, we had Espragia in here yesterday. He's been in about 40 years.
Yeah.
And even then, there's a lot of people like, Espragia who?
I think you need to get really old, and then you need to have like a comeback. So,
oh, like a comeback player of the year type thing.
So like 50 you know, years from now.
So you need to make like really great wine now.
Yeah, exactly.
And then like 3 or 4 years from now, make total crap wine. And then like 10 years later, be rejuvenated by a project. And then I'll be like, oh, Gavin Chanin.
Yeah.
You remember him?
Yeah, pretty much. I think that's the, every 10 years you need to do a little reset.
Well, I mean, fortunately for you, I think you're in the, at the very least, the good wine phase of your career. I would say the great wine phase of your career. Pretty early.
Yeah.
How long have you been doing this?
So, let's see. I started working in Santa Barbara in 2004. I started Chanin Wine Company in 2007, and then I partnered with Bill Price in 2011 to start Lutum. So, just finished my 13th harvest, or 14th maybe. I'd have to start counting on my fingers, which would be embarrassing. Yeah, just finished. It feels like more time than it actually has been. And I worked in, I worked in South Africa, New Zealand, two different wineries in New Zealand. So I got to cheat a little bit. I did a vintage where I snuck three harvests into 1 year.
Into 1 year.
Yeah.
Where'd you work in New Zealand?
A place called Bell Hill in Waipara.
Waipara? Oh, yeah, that's good dirt.
Outside of Christchurch, limestone, old limestone quarry, planted Burgundian style. We made... it was 9 or 12 barrels of wine using a lot of manual labor, and it was probably one of the most difficult harvests I've ever done.
Did it teach you anything about doing this gig?
One thing it taught me was watching people make a small amount of wine in the most dedicated way possible
right. Is
the coolest thing you can do for me in wine. So not cutting corners, not being worried about working late nights or being cold, just doing everything correctly from the start.
Yeah.
And also not having to really manage the vineyard. You know, I like to think when you have time and staff and dedication to do everything the way it should be, then you don't have to say like, oh, this is really important, we should do this now, and forget about this, which is less important. You just do everything.
You just do everything, yeah.
And
just
that's
do it all.
Yeah.
Is that the plan here?
It is. So Lutum, we started in 2011. It was pretty much an experiment in 2011. I met Bill at In Pursuit of Balance in San Francisco.
Mm-hmm.
And we just started talking, and Bill has a passion for Pinot, California Pinot, and also a passion for vineyards. I have the same, so we bonded over that. Bill was interested in Santa Rita Hills, which I had spent the last 9 years working with, and I've always been curious about Sonoma, which up until the time I really didn't know that much about. So they were really complementary skill sets, and we made 4 barrels of Jarel, and with you know, bottled it in Shiners, no name, no label, not quite sure where we were headed, and turned into a full-blown winery. So Lutum is Latin for dirt or soil, and the idea is just to find the best vineyards we can find, working with the most unique soils we can find, and seeing what we can do with it.
So what's the key for you as a winemaker when you're working with these different parcels, you know, to let the soil speak? Because everyone has their own way of making wine.
Yeah.
And I think whether they want to or not, the winemaker always kind of want to, there's like a hidden need to put your stamp on it, I think. Even if you don't think about it, you say, oh no, what do you do here to let these wines, you know, drop the soil hammer? You know,
I mean, you're always going to put a stamp on it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the wine wouldn't get made if you weren't putting some sort of stamp on it.
Right.
A big thing for us is, you know, having this passion for these unique sites and what can we do to show them. So, you know, all this stuff is cliche, but being hands off, all the wines are made in a very similar fashion. And honestly, we couldn't do that if the vineyards weren't so great. We work with such high quality fruit that we don't need to work a lot of magic in the cellar. So that's a big deal. And then making wines that are balanced with acidity and alcohol is a big deal, because I've found that once you cross a certain line, it's very hard to sense, you know, the unique elements of a Pinot, especially. So picking at the right time. And another big thing is working with the right people. So working with farmers that share our dedication. We work with a lot of different farmers. And that's really a key component of terroir that I think people think of terroir and they think of soil.
Yeah. Yeah.
Which is a huge component. But mm-hmm. to me, it's also the winemaker, the cellar crew, the guy who's farming. And if you don't keep those things consistent and in place, then you know, you're just going to be all over the map. So
it's funny you mentioned that because we were talking with a really great producer in Bordeaux, and they said the same thing. Because it's like terroirs, you know, effect of nature and everything. And it's like, no, terroirs is the people as well. Mm-hmm. And it was really, that point wasn't lost on me. Mm-hmm. And it's funny you mentioned that because it's the same type of thing again. The terroir is the impact because the wine has to be made.
Yeah.
Right? My gosh. Okay, so you have, this is a roll call of like brilliant vineyards.
Yeah, so we're lucky enough to work with, some of the oldest and most historic vineyards in Sonoma and in with Durell and Bienesito and then San Fran Benedict and Rinconada in the Central Coast. So there's no secret that we go after the oldest fruit we can find.
And the old vines in this case, the old vines in Bienesito, the old vines in San Fran Benedict, they are producing kind of like the better gear. You know, I mean, it's not a situation where like the four-year-old vines from these super groovy clones is making something up. Or is it more about, again, getting back to that terroir thing?
I think a lot of it's getting back to terroir. I find that the old vines, so a lot of times, well, with both these wines, we work with younger vines and older vines.
Mm-hmm.
And that's kind of our way of blending is we have these different components of the same vineyard. So Bienesito, we have three different unique blocks. And we typically treat the upper portion of each block and the lower portion differently. So we have essentially six blocks, which we might do multiple picks out of each. So it's funny, you look at making six different wines in 2012, and those six wines can feel like 30 different vineyards because we treat every spot uniquely. And but I love the old vines in Bienesito. You get all the spice and backbone, almost very, very little color.
Yeah.
But also a lot of concentration. Then the young vines fill everything out. They have color, they have fruit. Mm. So to me, it's a really nice combination.
So like the old vines make like this uber savory kind of like, you know, totally old school, that was the Pinot Noir I drink type vibe. And then the younger vines kind of just kind of turn it into wine for today.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, and they add, I mean, they both give and take various things. I'm not sure if we would want 100% of the old vines. And I know we wouldn't want 100% of the young vines, so
right.
Mixing it up. And young vines now we're working with 14-year-old, are the youngest vines that we work with at Bienesito. So we're not talking 5-6-year-old
right,
vines.
Right, no, you're not talking twigs.
Yeah, we're really talking mature vines versus very old. Very old for California, at least.
Dude, the S&B is smoking today.
Yeah.
and this is, this is like vines from the early 70s, right, a lot of it? Right.
S&B was planted in 72.
72.
And then our other portion was planted in the early 90s.
Early 90s. Now, this is getting back to your point. There's like an old school vibe to this wine, but there's a generosity of fruit that you don't see from like the gnarly, like traditional, like all old vine, like S&B type wines.
Yeah. And I think that's what Santa Rita Hills at its highest can give you. It gives you a wine with a ton of power, but it also has finesse and it has everything in balance. So it has a lot of fruit. It has a lot of spice. It has a lot of tannin. It has a lot of color.
Yeah, no, it's dark.
But it's still an elegant wine.
It's pretty. Just another one of, just, you know, rifling through all the greatest vineyards in the Central Coast. Just, you know, you do this every day, you're going to be bored with this.
I don't forget, especially during harvest when this fruit starts to roll in, how blessed we are to work with some of these vineyards. Even Durell, which my partner Bill owns, is a very difficult vineyard to get fruit from because the demand is so high.
Yeah.
San Fran Benedict was a good 5 years of nagging to get fruit out of. So squeaky wheel does get the grease, it turns out.
How was your first experience with Durell? So what'd you learn about Sonoma as opposed to the Central Coast?
The first thing that struck me is that the farmers are much more acceptable of high maintenance winemakers, which is nice. Which makes a little bit of sense, because I'd argue there's more high-maintenance guys up in the North Coast than there are in Santa Barbara. But
right.
I still get a kick out of the farmer, Rob Harris, asked me what time I wanted the fruit to be at the winery. And I said, like around 9. Rolled in at like 8:59. And we had fruit that we were picking down the street that I asked to be delivered in the morning. And it rolled in at like 11:20. So they had picked the fruit at night, got it on a truck. One of the vineyard guys drove it down like right on time, drove all night. And I was like, yeah, this is going to work well.
This is good.
Yeah.
I like this.
Yeah.
I could be a high maintenance North Coast winemaker.
Yeah.
I could do this.
It's not too hard.
We got about a minute left. What's the difference between the fruit that you're seeing in Sonoma and in general, like, you know, say between, you know, some like Santa Rita Hills and the Durell Vineyard with regards to like the difference in the fruit qualities of the wine?
So the section of Durell that we work in is pretty heavy volcanic soil, which I don't see anywhere in Santa Barbara.
Mm-hmm.
I think for us, going back to the soil, Sonoma Coast and Santa Barbara in the cool climates regions, so Santa Maria, Santa Rita Hills, Los mm-hmm. Alamos, have a perfect climate for Pinot. We get 130 growing days, which is 30 days more than Burgundy gets on a good year. So continental climate, warm winter, very cool summer. But the hard thing is finding really unique pieces of dirt. So you go from limestone and a ton of gravel at Bienocito to diatomaceous earth at Rinconada to chert and diatomaceous earth at Sanford and Benedict, and then volcanic soil at Durell. So.
Well, that's kind of different.
Yeah. So as far as the characters, very pure fruit. And then there's a very unique spice component on Durell that's like this kind of roasted beet. It's something I've been working on figuring out for a long time. I don't have quite the right word for it. But
you have to come up with the perfect dorky tasting note for it. Work on
I'm
it.
Working on it.
Working on it.
Okay. Give me a thesaurus.
Ladies and gentlemen, four of the coolest soil-based wines you're going to taste in California today, made by the soon-to-be world-famous Gavin Chanin.
Thank you for having me.
Thanks for coming, man. This was a hoot.
Thank you.
All right, let's drink now.
Awesome.
All right, cheers.
Cheers.